This complex Fibonacci video is thanks to Jane Street, who kindly support the Stand Up Maths channel. These are the Fibonacci numbers, which some people get very excited about. And yes, it's a matter of public record that when it comes to these sequences where you add two terms to get the next one, I'm a huge fan of the Lucas numbers, where you start 2-1. But I can see an argument that the Fibonacci numbers, which start 1-1, are a more kind of simple, a quintessential form of the add two terms to get the next one sequence. Although you could probably argue that maybe 1-2, that's an even nicer starting point for Fibonacci. Why don't we start 1-1? Or why not, because we can go a little bit further the other way, why not start 0-1? That's a cool, nice, simple starting point. I would accept that argument for why Fibonacci is the way to go. Although, hang on. I mean, if we can go 0-1, why not go further that way? I mean, people are very familiar. You can go as far as you want that way, but what if we come one back? Negative numbers, there we go. We can go -1, 0. That's a great series, so why not 1, -1? In fact, we can go as far as we want that way. The Fibonacci numbers extend in both directions. Most people just don't think about negative valued Fibonacci numbers. And as a bit of an experiment, because I was curious, I had a puzzle recently on my separate series of videos, Matt Parker's Mass Puzzles, where it was a Fibonacci style problem. People had to submit two starting values of that kind of sequence. And while I didn't heavily imply you could use negative numbers, I did hint they were possible, and arguably they were the better solution to the puzzle. And of the over 2,000 valid starting numbers for a sequence that different people sent in, only 17.2% of them used any negative numbers. So most people just didn't cross their minds. So there you are, you can extend the Fibonacci sequence in the negative direction. I actually wrote about this several years ago in my book, Things to Make and Do in the Fourth Dimension, and there's a few interesting things about it. So some people may know, if you look at the ratio between two terms in sequence going in the positive direction, that approaches the golden ratio. If you go in the negative direction, it approaches the negative of the inverse of the golden ratio, which is kind of fun, and the numbers are the same, but they alternate positive and negative. And you know what, I wrote a little bit about some of that stuff, and then I kind of, you know, filed it away. Mildly interesting, but not astounding. However, when I was thinking about this puzzle and I suddenly thought, hang on, are there any other interesting things about how we can extend the Fibonacci numbers? I went through the stuff I'd done before and I went, hang on a second, I've only ever looked at extending it in terms of discrete whole numbers going in both directions. Is there a way to fill the gaps? And there is a trivial way to do it. You can just take points that are in between. So if instead of adding the whole numbers, if you imagine them on, let's say, a number line, you can go part way along. So if you go part way between 0 and 1, let's say a third, but it could be, you know, 3/7, a pi, whatever you fancy, you then, well, the next one, because you've got those two ones together, there's no points between them. You always have one for the next term, and then you'll actually hit the same ratio all the way along. And because that works for any real number in the first range, you can include any arbitrary point on the real number line in a Fibonacci style sequence, but it's not particularly interesting or exciting. But then I remembered something else. I had remembered this, the Binet formula. Now, I've talked a lot in other videos about how you can generate things like the Fibonacci and Lucas sequences. I'll link to them all below, but I have not mentioned the Binet formula. And it does look very, very Fibonacci-y. It's got the golden ratio to the power of n. It's got the negative inverse of the golden ratio, also the power of n. And of course, you're dividing it by the square root of 5. Big fan. Links to other videos below. Now, this formula is amazing because if you put in any value of n, it will give you the nth Fibonacci number. And it doesn't just work going forwards. If you put in n equals 0, you get the 0th Fibonacci number. 0. If you put in negative values of n, you get the negative Fibonacci numbers. It works perfectly forwards and backwards. And I thought, you know what? I can use this to try and fill in the gaps. What happens if we don't put in a whole value of n? What if we put in a fractional value of wait, that's not gonna work, because you can see there's a negative number there, negative of the inverse, the golden ratio, that's a negative value. And if you raise something to a fractional value, that's effectively taking a root. And of course, you can't have the root of a negative number unless you allow complex results. If we put in the fractional values of n to get the in-between values in the Fibonacci sequence, we're gonna get complex results. I was so excited when I realized this, and I did it. Initially, just for positive real values of n. So here on the number line, I've marked the whole number Fibonacci values. We already know those. And somehow, we're gonna have to go from 0. We're gonna have to hit 1 twice, and then hit all the other ones going up. Okay, we'll see what happens. So I coded up the Binet formula in Python, because you can use that to handle complex numbers. I then put the real and complex values out into Excel, and I used it to plot the function. And this is what I got. Look at that. It does a loop-de-loop, so it goes through 1 twice. It gives this fantastic line. These are complex values, and whenever they cross the real line, you get a whole number Fibonacci map. When I first saw that, I just tell you what, I very quickly had to find my amazed face. And okay, here it comes. Ready? This is what I look like. Amazing! And of course, we can do the negative values of n. Interestingly, this is gonna have to skip backwards and forwards between positive and negative whole real values. So sure enough, you start putting in the negative values of n into the Binet formula, and you get a spiral. That's how it skips backwards and forwards. And every single time it hits the real axis, it always crosses it at a whole number. It's, I guess we're doing the amazed face thing again. No, that's fine, it is pretty amazing. So ready? Amazing. For the record, these are not the same scale on the vertical axis. These are my actual original Excel plots, not made to look fancy or anything. And for the negative value of n1, it is the same scale in both directions, both for the real and imaginary numbers. This is when I was plotting n going from 0 to 5. And at the peak there, the imaginary component gets almost up to 4. Whereas for positive values of n, that vertical axis only goes up to just over 0.2. So if you were to plot both of them at the same time, all the details from the positive one are totally lost, right? It's barely going above and beyond the real axis, whereas the nature of the spiral literally spirals out of control. Fine, we'll do it. We'll try a complex value of n, because if we can put in real values of n and get out complex results, what's to stop us putting in complex values of n? And nothing mathematical, to be honest. The Binet formula works great if you put in complex values of n and look at the complex results you get out. The issue is our brains, because a complex number is effectively a two-dimensional number, and if you're putting in a whole range of 2D numbers and getting a different range of 2D numbers out, that's a four-dimensional plot to be able to look at all of it at once. And as previously discussed, I am a huge fan of four-dimensional objects, but our brains don't play nicely with such things. So there's no easy way to visualize it. We were kind of cheating before by taking a 1D input, which is just the real number line, and then plotting the 2D result around it. And I started thinking, how on earth am I going to visualize this? And what I decided to do was to show all the values of n going in as a two-dimensional surface, the complex plane, and then just look at one component at a time. And initially, I thought, well, you know, I tried to picture what that's gonna look like. I mean, if you get a spiral, a spiral coming out is both of them oscillating up and down, because the real value is going up and down, the imaginary number is going up and down, so I knew I should kind of see waves in the result. So once again, I fired up Python, I put the numbers into Excel, I tried to plot them using the built-in Excel 3D plot. So there you are, that's the real component of all the values that come out of the Binet formula if you put in complex values of n, and here's all the imaginary components. So yeah, you can kind of see that wavy effect, but it's not very easy to explore it. At this point, I realized I'd reached the limit of me trying to cobble together bad Python code with the bad built-in visualizations in Excel. So I got rid of all of that. I contacted my friend Ben Sparks, who you may know from various Numberphile videos and other fantastic things that Ben does. I work with Ben a lot doing mass communication work, and Ben is an absolute ninja when it comes to using GeoGebra. Of course, Ben could do what I couldn't in GeoGebra. He made this. Right, so this is just the imaginary component, and again, you've got the complex plane for all values of n going in, but now I can grab it and I can move it around. And because we haven't got the issues I was having before in Excel where it was cutting off at weird values, GeoGebra is far better at doing this because it was designed to do it. You can now move it around, you can see. So there's that red line down the center there, the one that goes from here and then kind of goes all the way back up over there, that one there. That is the real number line. So originally that's the only bit we were looking at. And as I twist it around, you can see there, there's the kind of, this is the negative direction over here. So that's where you get the undulating up and down complex value that formed the spiral. And then in this direction over here, that, so this is kind of cool. You can see these, the undulation goes off. And so by the time you're over here at the positive values, you're, look at it, I made it spin. Look at that. Then you get the bits where you get like that loop-de-loop, but then it carries on for ages, just ducking above and below the real line. And you don't have to stop here. If I stop that from spinning, we should be able to zoom out so we can see more of it at once. So, oop, wrong way, here we go, out, out, out. So, look at these, you start to get these things. Well, like, what's going on over it? There's another one of these, where'd that come from? So if we zoom back, in fact, there are more of them, and you can see they line up, that's, if you can see it, that's 10. Positive 10 on the real number line over there. You get these ones where they get these huge spikes, and they don't stop at the top there, by the way. So that, you can see the top here, it looks like they kind of cap out. They've not capped out, that's just where GeoGebra is limiting how far it's drawing, so it's not drawing everything above that. And you can see they go off in the other direction. Underneath, you can see here, they start really low and they come racing up and then they curl around out onto the, so cool. And so I don't know what's going on over there, that's kind of fun. I'm gonna zoom back in again, so you can see, I was very impressed. And oh look, it's my very impressed face, ready? Very impressed. This does open up yet another way of exploring this four-dimensional plot that we unfortunately cannot visualize. And like I said, so we were looking before at the slice down that real number line, so the red line that goes all the way back along there. We were just taking that as the input and then looking at the 2D complex plot that comes out of it. But why don't we pick a different line? In fact, instead of choosing that, we could increase the imaginary value, right? And what if we picked a line like one that goes across the complex plane over here somewhere? Like, I don't know, I'm pointing totally the wrong way compared to that. You get the idea, right? So instead of, let me do it end on, right? So instead of going along here, why don't we go like along over here somewhere or along over there somewhere? We could have a constant imaginary amount and then vary the real number. You could do more complicated things than that, but that was my first idea, and Ben very, very kindly initially coded up a better version of what I had done before. There you go. It's also interactive, and you can change the amount of imaginary number for the slice you're looking at. And as you vary yourself around the complex plane, staying parallel to the real number line, you can see that the plot changes. And so this is a different way of exploring it. We're kind of moving through different 2D cross sections of the plot. And you could have more exotic lines which aren't parallel to the real number line, but you can work that out yourself. Ben has made this version available for free. I'll put a link in the description. You get it and the other plot I was playing with a second ago. Yep, that one there. And you can, to your heart's content, have a go. And if it looks like things disappear, as I said before, that's not an actual nature of the plot. Often that's just, we had to cap how far GeoGebra bothers going. But it's all below. Download it, have a play. Quickly, there is another way you can visualize things, and that's by just taking the absolute value of the complex number when it comes out. So you have the complex plane visualized going in, and then just the magnitude of the answer. So you effectively ignore the direction where the complex number is, and just as its distance from zero plus zero y. And I initially tried that in Excel and got a terrible plot. Undeterred, I thought I would just filter out and find the interesting bits. And for some reason, I thought, wouldn't it be fun to look for the zeros? So I did a map of where the lowest values are, and I got this. I became a bit obsessed with that little dot by itself, and I worked out the exact coordinates of where it was. But then I thought, I wonder if there are more zeros. Contacted Ben. Ben made this for me in GeoGebra. So it's another plot. That's the complex plane going in. You still got the red is the real axis, green is imaginary. This time it's the absolute value of the result that comes out. And what I was showing you before, if you look at it kind of this way, all of this plane, that whole plane kind of there is super small. So if I angle it down, you can see it's pretty much, look at it, it's flat. It's like a sheet that's just been dropped on the complex plane, right? So that's like, goes off to zero there, but then races up massive in both these directions. You get these two kind of lines where it just goes straight up, which is phenomenal. And then you've got the zeros. So what I was looking at was all the way in here. If we zoom right in, you can just see as it starts to lift up off the plane, it touches and then touches, and then these are, so it touches there and then touches again just about there and then there and then there, and as you zoom out it keeps doing that. And it looks like these ones that we've just seen, these ones out here, it looks like there's a wee gap there where it doesn't quite touch the axis. That's just the resolution. If you zoom right in, or if GeoGebra did a higher resolution processing, because this is just on the fly trying to visualize it for us, that would just continue down. It's too skinny to see and hit the axis. And as you zoom, oops, further wrong way, further and further out, all of these, they keep heading down and all of them touch the axis. And there's like a whole lot of them. And they'll, they're there. I actually then use Wolfram Alpha to solve for the zeros, and they're all in a dead straight line. I think there's infinitely many of them. And I had a lot of fun with that. So anyway, this is just to say, you can have a lot of fun with mathematics. So I started off by thinking, I wonder what happens if we extend the Fibonacci numbers, and I ended up exploring where weird zeros are in a four-dimensional plot of the Binet functions. Who knows where maths will take you? Well, I know a few places. Before I say goodbye, I've got two last things to show you that both answer the where can you end up by following mathematics question. And and there's my goodbye face. I better hurry up. So first of all, this video is sponsored by Jane Street. They are, of course, the principal sponsor of my stand-up maths channel. And if you enjoy mathematics, you enjoy problem solving, and you're looking for a job, then Jane Street might be for you. They use incredible bits of mathematics to solve complex problems in the financial world. So if this is the kind of stuff you're into and you're looking for gainful employment, Jane Street, they support my channel. I think they're great. Do check them out. For everyone else, just appreciate the fact that they support my channel and they make these videos possible. There you are. So mathematics might end up getting you a job, or actually, you know what, I'm gonna zoom out a little bit to buy myself some more time. Okay, there we go. Right, secondly, mathematics can take you to really unusual places. Along my journey, I discovered something amazing. So yes, the Fibonacci numbers, the ratio between them approaches a limit as you go further and further. The area under the plot of the Binet function, because it ducks above and below the real axis as it goes further and further in the positive real direction, the area under each bit where it goes above and below, that also approaches a limit. And the limit is 2/5 times the natural log of course, the golden ratio. all divided by pi. So there you are. I mean, I was kind of expecting the golden ratio, the fact that it was a natural log. I'm like, fair enough, we're looking at areas, but divided by pi, there you are. So it turns out, whatever you do in mathematics, you're gonna end up with pi. And that is the end of the video. Thanks very much.